This talk will cover some of my interest in the career of psychology that I've pursued, and it started really with an integration theme. So the abstract, this PowerPoint you can receive if, I think there's a sign-up board if you want to you want the slides later for something that I skip over too much. At any rate, just a few items about my journey to kind of give context here. I started as a person interested in science, grew up in a liberal church, and when I say liberal, I mean the pastor was trained by Paul Tillich. We had professed atheists singing in the choir, very formal, proper Presbyterian liturgy, but then after I went through confirmation class and went to the adult Sunday school class, we had discussions like, when you pray, it's not like someone's actually there listening, so what is prayer for? And around that same time, I was about 15 to 16, I ran into a friend who was studying to go to law school as like a six-year-old. Now he was very debate-oriented, and he attended a conservative Baptist church. And he tried to convince me that I could actually believe the Bible, something my church gave me the impression I could do when I was in preschool, but not after. And over a period of about 6 months, reading Lewis and Schaefer and a bunch of books he would give me, I became a Christian. I had a fairly classic born-again experience. I attended a Baptist youth group, InterVarsity at our local college campus. This was in the mid-70s in the heyday of the Jesus movement. So then I started doing street ministry, worked at a Christian camp, and never planned to go to college, even though I was academically oriented. I liked study, but the Jesus movement thought, you know, you and your Bible, that's all you needed. The very end of that movement, I went to a national conference where people said, if you want to have credibility in the community, even though you don't need any of that formal training to be effective for Christ, it's a good idea to get a degree just to open doors. So, okay, sounds good. So 2 months before the start of a school year, I applied to Wheaton and Taylor because I had run into Wheaton and Taylor psychology undergrads at a Christian camp I worked at, and they talked about this thing called integration, which sounded good to me. So I was reading the integration books throughout the Christian bookstores, and that sounded like something I wanted to do. I had some interest in psychology before that. I was in Boy Scouts for years. My scoutmaster was the chair of the local state university psychology department, also not a Christian, but interesting guy. My sister was a social worker, and I would read her college psych textbooks from the university, that sort of thing. So that brought me in this direction of pursuing psychology, and I thought about coming to Wheaton or Taylor, but Wheaton had a six-month waiting list, so I'm a Taylor grad. So that's how that came about. So my journey with integration really starts there in those months leading up to grad school, the year or two when I was reading some of the 1970s integration texts, and then into Taylor. So the psychology program at Taylor emphasized worldview integration, strong liberal arts background, a professor there by the name of Mark Cosgrove that I'll talk about a little bit later, that was his forte. I also, though, took as much as I could at the philosophy and religion department. I came to believe that philosophy was sort of the missing link in integration, that a lot of what we needed to do was draw on philosophical ideas or concepts to engage this field. Went off to this program at Bowling Green, where I got to do a thesis on an applied topic in psychology. Ken Pargent was actually on my master's thesis committee there, and then decided what direction to go from that point. My wife wanted me to get into a career that I could make money at, so that led me into psychology instead of philosophy, but actually, I really did enjoy that background, continued to study some philosophy as I went into the program at Bowling Green. Now, since I had this integration goal, why stay at Bowling Green? So I planned on going to Fuller, other places, but Ken Pargament was one of the few folks doing psychology religion research in a mainstream university, and I found his approach to religion and coping to be very helpful to thinking about how faith can be a resource for people, how it can be a resource in clinical work, and ended up staying working with him, and I really felt that was the correct decision to make at that point. So on to my Air Force career. As a psychologist in the Air Force, many people from Christian programs, I think this is true for Wheaton as well, find themselves in military internships or military career paths because the values tend to be congruent with those courses. But what I found was that in this context, I could practice rather openly. Often the faith community was deeply connected to the military service community, and so pastors would refer people to me. And I don't know that I thought of what I did there as integration. What I saw myself doing is just being a psychologist who thought a lot about Christian things and was explicit or open with Christian topic as we moved throughout the different kinds of therapy cases I encountered. So on to UMass Medical Center, and then Regent, where I've been since 1997. At Regent, we've been able to explicitly pursue integration projects, of course, but I did a fair amount of that in my prior career. So am I an integrationist? Am I a parallel person who's had in practice, a kind of secular career consistent with Christian values? I don't know, my thoughts on all of that have evolved over the years. I do like integration. I'm just as committed to these topics and interests as I was when I started my undergraduate journey years ago. And I'll try to explain where my thinking has gone as I've followed this evangelical integration project from the 1970s forward. Okay. So skip that. All right, so let's talk about a case. This is one I had in my first assignment, which before I went to Germany was in South Carolina. So if you want to deal with issues of ultimacy and spiritual concern, start your practice career 11 days after a war breaks out. So I arrived at the base with all the mental health folks deployed to Desert Storm, and I was the only person left. Reopened the base and had 20 walk-ins, three of whom I had to hospitalize, who all thought it was going to be Vietnam, and they wanted their husbands back right then. And I was in a new community in another part of the country with no one else there. So you can imagine I spent a lot of time on the phone back to my internship supervisors. Fortunately, in the military, they continue to be accessible. But issues of ultimacy, of meaning, of what is life all about, came up a lot that year of warfare, where I was not deployed, but just back dealing with the aftermath of a community where a deployment had happened. And during the Reagan buildup years, people sort of thought the military was a place to go to get an education, but they didn't really expect us to be in any kind of active war. So it was a very interesting experience to be at that time in that process. Well, at any rate, this is someone I saw in those years. So this was a woman who was from France. She had married 3 years earlier an enlisted airman. She was from a kind of middle class background and had an interesting journey where she explored different kinds of life paths. So she had worked in the service industry. She had been in a lesbian relationship for a number of years, left that. And somehow met this guy who was stationed in France briefly. They got married, and he was from the South, kind of all the stereotypic kind of patterns you expect with a Southern white male, kind of fit what he was like. And so she comes back to them. They have a child. They're living in a small rural Southern community, and here she is with this background, and they're going to a church. And so she comes in for what she describes as depression. And you can imagine with this journey, you're wondering, okay, so what's going on here? Is it cultural adjustment issues? Is it that she was this sort of progressive? She described herself as feminist, liberal, who's now in this very traditional homemaker role in the rural South, out of the country. So France, from France to the South, it's not exactly a kind of typical path for people to take. Was it a sexual identity issue? So I'm wondering all those things, and I start exploring them with her. Let me just say, in terms of her depression, even though that's the description she used, she had no significant CGI caps. So if you're around psychiatrists, they use that abbreviation. These are the neurovegetative symptoms of depression. So problems with sleep, interest, concentration, appetite, the psychomotor symptoms. So she really didn't have a clinical depression, maybe a low-level dysthymia, but probably not even that. What she really had was something more like anomie, or sort of an existential longing for something more in her life. And as I talked to her over multiple sessions, it was clear that was her issue, her struggle, even before she met this person and did this extraordinary experiment of going from France and that background to rural South housewife in the United States. So I didn't see it as a sexual identity issue. I didn't see it as an issue that had to do with gender identity or women's roles specifically. What she was really looking for is just wondering what her life should be about. And our therapy then sort of went in that direction. What did she do that gave her life a sense of meaning? What kinds of activities, volunteer work, other things? that she might do. We talked about the kinds of things that sort of gave her a sense of, this is why I'm getting up in the morning, and that's more the direction we went. I think that there's much in people's lives like that, that are about the search for meaning, and much of our therapy sort of sidesteps that. Although there have been people like Viktor Frankl, people like Crystal Park now who do research in this area, by and large, meaning takes a backseat to positive affect, anxiety, these kind of direct emotional states that we're all sort of preoccupied with, or functional impairment in a more intense way in social functioning or occupational functioning. And yet, the Bible seems to give us this picture about a motivation that's deep inside people for something of significance. Augustine certainly had that same idea as well, that drawing from the theme in Ecclesiastes, we have sort of eternity in our hearts, this motivation. Whether or not it's ultimately fulfilled in Christ, which I think is the perfect fulfillment of that longing, it's clear the longing is there, and that without this, what we have is a series of diversions throughout our life. In fact, Sartre basically admitted it when he said, what we do in this life is occupy ourselves with projects and living, right? We give ourselves little things to do while we're waiting to die, and that's about the best we can do from an atheistic perspective. But it's still implied we get to be busy with something, and that's how we move ahead with life. If we're taking seriously the notion that spiritual and existential longings are central to human existence, where does this take us? Now, I'd had some background in this from philosophy, from death and dying courses in philosophy. Our director of our doctoral program was a phenomenologist who was the International Association of Thanatology, so death and dying. And so he was a clinician, but also he was a philosopher, but also a counselor around grief issues. And so that kind of background prepared me more than all of my training in psychology, except for some of the stuff in religion and coping with Dr. Pargament. And he also noted that when he saw people deal with end-of-life issues or serious life disruptions, they often use words in therapy like, I find solace from, or, you know, this is how I make sense of what this is supposed to be about. So meanings that were not psychology-oriented kinds of ways of talking, but more from a spiritual tradition. Even if they were not spiritual, even if they didn't know about his background, they were just seeing him as a secular therapist in Toledo. All right, so where does that take me? So early on, I had this sense that our therapy is helpful. I found many people that seemed to benefit from standard sort of psychological treatments, but it wasn't quite hitting the center of human existence. And I think that's largely because what we're trying to integrate around is the field that's defined from a different agenda. And we're doing sort of a reactive integration over the last 4 to 5 decades. Now, I know there are exceptions here, and I'm painting with too broad a brush strokes, but in general, what we're trying to do is figure out how to be Christians in the field of psychology, counseling, or social work, the way that those fields have been constituted. I think there's room for us to be more proactive. Now, someone like Eric Johnson in his Society for Christian Psychology is attempting to do this, but he's trying to do it, I think, starting from a Christian theological vantage point that doesn't adequately include the empirical, sort of what people 150 years ago might have called inductive information from scientific psychology. And so I think we might be reinventing the wheel by going down that path. Although certainly I appreciate his serious engagement with just what can we learn about the person from a biblical or exegetical tradition. So, some definitions of integration from the Oxford English Dictionary. There are people that want to move beyond this term. So I don't know if you've heard those discussions, if you had them here. Because they either say it's too truncated, or it has the idea that things are separate, that should be one, that sort of thing. I would love to move beyond this. In fact, I would like to have God's understanding of the world, but I don't expect to have that tomorrow. And so in the meantime, while I'm a fallible human, I suspect I'll have to put things together from an incomplete perspective to get a more complete perspective. That's what I suspect. And so that's why this still makes sense to me as a term. So how did we get to where we are now? I'm going to do some digression here. a little bit of mini history and systems lecture. Sorry, I'll move through that quickly for those of you who dread history and systems. I actually kind of like it. I was playing a YouTube clip on the Chicago World's Fair in the 1800s that introduced the contemporary new psychology to the world. So you all are partly to blame for this here in Chicago. But I think early on, modern psychology started to get married to a secular approach in a variety of ways. So first of all, a naturalistic and mechanistic framework was adopted by people who argued for what was then called the new psychology. And by that, they meant not phrenology, not spiritualism, not just theological anthropology, something of that sort. James McCosh is at the center of that movement. He was a representative of the Scottish intellectual tradition, a tradition informed by Calvinist Presbyterian kinds of understandings from Scotland. He came over to Princeton, became the president after they'd already started using one of his books on the new psychology as their standard course for their psychology course at Princeton. It was in its second edition by the time he arrived there. So his students, people like Baldwin, took the new psychology and moved it away from the kind of theological discussions he often had. So I've read his texts. If you read those texts from the mid-1800s, what you see is a lot of God language mixed in with some language that sounds like what we'd see in a standard psychology textbook today. So the reason that he felt we could move into the new psychology was that he thought God had given all people, Christian or not, certain faculties that allowed them to discover certain truths about the world, had providentially provided those faculties. This was the Scottish common sense tradition, or the faculty psychology that came from it. Well, one of your own PsyD students did his doctoral dissertation on this in 1999, I think, right? So Brian Mayer, is that how you say his name? Meyer? And he wrote this great article in the history of psychology called The Role of James McCosh in God's Exile from Psychology. Now, I think he's a little bit harsh on McCosh with that phrase, but there's some truth to it. So his students certainly stopped using God language. It wasn't just McCosh's doing, but he gave a theological framework that made it okay to study the soul, psychology, without talking about religious stuff. So these are three points that came out of his project, McCosh's project. So that there should be a clear division of intellectual labor. So the new sciences had developed to the point where the people that were using the techniques of the new sciences had skills that theologians couldn't master unless they became dual trained in that other discipline. On the same token, in theory, theologians had training that the new scientists didn't have, and so he thought that there should be a division of labor here and one shouldn't try to do the other's work. Also, if you were dual trained in both, you shouldn't mix the two because they had different approaches, different faculties, different investigative tools that were used for their explorations. Now, he believed even if discoveries were made in the new psychology that were at odds with sort of a biblical view of the person, we didn't have to worry about it because over time, as we understood more, all truth is God's truth, it will all be reconciled, it will all fit together. The third point was that although they are appropriately separate, because they are appropriately separate, there doesn't need to be any theological standard or test for any discovery made in psychology. Now, something very similar happened around evolution at Princeton a few years after McCosh was there. So he started arguing for the compatibility of evolution with at least the basic findings of evolution with Christian belief, although he didn't believe in chance as the driver for evolution. He believed it was divine design or providence. So the person who was the head of the seminary, Hodge, I think was his name at the time, right? So was it Hodge? Argued against Darwin's view. And so that debate went on 10 years and engulfed a lot of American academia. And by the end of it, many folks were not concerned about evolution. So much so that when the fundamentals, those series of pamphlets were published and funded and sent out to every pastor by Phillips, the Phillips 66, 76 guy, the oil baron, there were several articles that talked about how being a Christian and being a Bible-believing Christian was compatible with evolution with some adjustments. So the first fundamentalists, that is the people who authored these tracts, were not anti-evolution, largely because of McCosh's influence. at Princeton. So where does that take us? Well, this is setting the theological stage, and then we have folks going to study with Wundt in Germany, the new experimental tradition. So Wundt's lab in Leipzig, the official start date for experimental psychology was his lab at Leipzig, 1879. It's a picture of Wundt there, using introspection and other techniques, such as reaction time measures, to study perception and how it relates to the physical characteristics of stimuli. Wundt argued that we could use these objective methods of the natural sciences to develop a scientific psychology. Now, an interesting caveat, he also believed that there was the realm of meaning and semantics and experience and subjectivity that could not be studied that way. So Wundt actually argued for two psychologies, a folk psychology that would be like based on the methods of the humanities and one based on the methods of the natural sciences. But his experimentalist children and great-grandchildren listened to the one side but not the other. So they moved ahead with experimental psychology. And we had the laboratory tradition. There was a lab already in the United States by James at Harvard that did similar things, more poorly equipped. But by 1900, there were more than 100 labs around the world, 40 in the US, as a result of people that had studied with or been inspired by Wundt. Here's just some of his trainees that created labs at a few places you might recognize in the United States. This is a very quick development of a new discipline, right? So these folks were all doing philosophy. It sounded like philosophy or theology 50 years earlier in these departments, and now they're doing this stuff, largely out of philosophy departments. Walter Scott Dill is important at the bottom there. Does anyone know why? So his measurement methods around human abilities inspired some early screening tests for the Army Alpha Beta test. And he was then also appointed the head of the first Army personnel system. This is the beginning of the Army entrance exams. As World War I approached, there were so many people coming in. Technology in the military had gotten to the point where we needed to have people that were technically proficient. So we had to, more quickly than we could learn through training, figure out who should shoot the cannons and who should be the cannon fodder. So he developed tests to help figure that out. That is, what positions people should be in. And really gave rise to modern personnel psychology through that movement. But it came from this earlier tradition of measurement, measuring and predicting behavior. At the same time, these folks started writing in the popular press. Although this is primarily an academic movement, they wanted people to know that they were studying the person in a very different way than what had happened before. They were asking some age-old questions that philosophers had speculated about. They were using scientific methods to approach them. And this is where the phrase new psychology picked up. It was really showcased to the world here in Chicago at the Columbian Exposition, the first World's Fair, in the back of the anthropology lab and the backside of the exhibit. And it was very popular. After that, several articles came out in things like Harper Magazine. So G. Stanley Hall wrote the new psychology. So did John Dewey, but John Dewey's article was more philosophical in nature. This article just showed pictures of all these experimental procedures like this one. This is the first page of the article. Here's a quote from Hall. This perhaps best marks the beginning of new psychology. He was talking about an experiment about 50 years earlier, which looked at when you have people touched at different places in their body all at once, how can they accurately discriminate where they're touched, and is there greater sensitivity when pressure points are acted on the body at different places than others? Anyhow, he said, this perhaps marks the beginning of the new psychology, which experiments on the soul and which has made former knowledge of it definite and added vastly to it. Experiments on the soul. So think about that phrase. This is how people were thinking back then. Another part of what led to the need for integration was not only this secularization and sort of naturalistic or mechanistic approach to the study of the soul, but we also saw at that time people of conventional or conservative religious faith, conservative is how we would define it now, move away from the academy And you've heard this story here, so certainly a number of scholars of Wheaton have chronicled this in great detail, or the experts at it, but the 19th century saw the secularization of the academy. We saw articles coming out by folks like Draper and White on the warfare of science and religion, articles that contemporary historians of science now view as largely flawed and inaccurate. But back then it was part of the mythology that religion is the source of opposition to the truth in scientific progress, where science needs to be emancipated from that domain. So also, in the wake of the Scopes trial, we saw fundamentalism go a very different place from where it was in those early pamphlets that fundamentalism is named after. It became rabidly anti-evolutionary. And that also brought with it a strong reaction against the sort of trends that were happening in the academy. So we know the story. Fundamentalist subcultures were created. Places like Wheaton and Taylor were here before that. But there were a whole series of Christian schools that popped up that were part of this reaction to modernism. So we also saw what Bill Austin has referred to as the closeting of theism in the mid-20th century. If you were a traditional theist and you were in a state university, you were viewed as weak-minded if you admitted your traditional faith. And so Bill Austin, who was for years chair of philosophy at Syracuse, said that when the Christian turn happened in that discipline, when it became acceptable to be openly Christian and to do philosophy asking specifically Christian questions in the last two or three decades, he said it felt like coming out of the closet for him. Even someone like Al Plantinga cut his teeth earlier in his career on logic, on modal logic and stuff, not philosophy of religion per se. That came a little bit later in his development. So this started changing largely because of those philosophers and a few others that started questioning these things. So I want to suggest that what we had then by the mid-20th century is a pretty clear institutional divorce in academia between people that look to the Bible as a source of truth that should guide what we think about things, not only religious things, but life in general, and people that look to secular academic methods to develop their worldview. But what we saw in the integration movement was an attempt to remarry the two. And you can see why, given that, a remarriage would be needed. So the divorce had not been complete, but it had been nearly complete. There was at least a long-standing separation going on at that point. So certainly we saw already in the 50s a number of books come out by people like Wayne Oates and others who were in the pastoral counseling tradition that wanted to read psychology and draw from it what was useful. This is not primarily in psychology departments, but pastoral counselors re-engaging a discussion with psychology. Fuller was launched in 1965. John Vanger was a psychologist who had been a chaplain on Iwo Jima, studied with Skinner, worked with Margaret Mead, worked with Kinsey, had a very interesting career journey. Strong Christian, but through this completely secular training route, and he was asked to be one of the consultants in Fuller's founding, and he told me that their goal when they met to decide what should we create in a psychology department that is Christian, they said they wanted to reposition psychology with the cross at the center. That's the way they talked about it. Now, do we have Fuller grads here? Any Fuller grads in the faculty? Okay, lots of friends at Fuller, so I don't mean to badmouth Fuller, but you can decide whether or not they've achieved that, but they certainly have done a lot to help us down this integration path. They've certainly made it an intentional effort. We also saw the rise of other programs. There's the dates that I had readily available. So Rosemead founded in Rosemead, California, then later on moved and joined BIOLA. And what does BIOLA stand for? Christian History Trivia for Evangelicals? The Bible Institute of Los Angeles, by R.A. Torrey, one of the early fundamentalists, right? Okay, so Azusa Pacific, Wheaton, Regent, Seattle Pacific. Now, there are places like Baylor or Brigham Young that also are part of this story, but in somewhat different ways. Baylor had to take on APA to become accredited simply because they were a Baptist institution, although they largely operated as a straightforward secular program with some exceptions with particular individual faculty. And Brigham Young has also tried to do some integrative things, but from a different kind of faith tradition, of course, so I don't have them on the list here for our discussion. We saw in the 1970s journals launched, and then the pursuit of models, which we'll be talking about a little later on. Okay, move on. Why do we need integration? Let me answer this question from a theological perspective. So one of our doctoral students at Regent did her dissertation focusing on this, Rebecca Thompson. And she points out that much of integration can be thought of from an Augustinian lens, which is we have a fallen world that needs to be restored to wholeness. So integration then is a repairing what was damaged or lost, a returning to wholeness, our view of the world. But when you read Irenaeus, there's this other understanding of the fall that predates Augustine. And Irenaeus argues that we were not born immortal, that death didn't occur because we sinned, but death occurred because of our state that we were in, which was a sort of infantile developmental state. And although God didn't want us to sin or to die, it's not a surprise that it happened because children make mistakes. It's a very different idea than a perfect creation that goes wrong to an idea of a early developed creation that's only innocent because it's naively innocent. And then through experience, it learns hard lessons that God providentially directs for our benefit. From this point of view, integration is part of the need of a developing creature's understanding of the world with God-given faculties, but still in a developmentally immature state. So it's a different kind of perspective that I would just suggest. These are quotes from Against Heresies where you see Irenaeus developing his idea about the nature of the fall. I'm not endorsing either one. I just think it's an interesting alternative to the idea that there used to be an approach. We didn't have all the experimental data, but we had a Christian view of the world that was better. Then the academy was fallen, and now our job is to restore it back to a perfect state and get back on that trajectory. From this point of view, this pursuit of inductive investigation of the person that divorces from faith might be a mistake that wouldn't be surprising for developing incomplete creatures to make, but that we can learn from and then pick ourselves up and find a better path. So the Irenaean view might suggest integration is not so much restoration as it is formation, part of our developmental spiritual journey. In all these talks about integration, we have questions of normativity. So how should we believe, what should decide for us what we should believe? Integration, if it's going to occur, requires us to combine truth claims from Christianity and from psychology. Now, if these never conflict, that's simply like zipping up a zipper. You get a sense when you read McCosh, this is what he thought might happen. Maybe this is a little bit oversimplistic, because he knew there might be transient tensions. But ultimately, when we fully understand the natural world and we have a really good theology, which for him would have been his Scottish Presbyterianism. So when we have a really good theology, you just zip it up and it all fits together, and now we have the encyclopedias filled out for time and eternity. Okay, that kind of a picture of things. But if they do conflict, then we have the problem of who do we give preference to, which point of view? Or is there a way to resolve the conflict? If we believe in normativity but don't think there should be integration, we might do that for a couple of reasons. So you've seen these positions, right? There are anti-integrationists. Not all, but the founders of the biblical counseling movement don't see much value in psychology, and so it's just the Bible and reject the psychology. There's no integration there because you only have one domain. Or you can see folks that are positivistic psychologists that reject any kind of claim to truth on theological grounds. And these folks are not hard to find in psychology. They certainly also would not see value in integration. But there are people like Stephen Jay Gould who believed that both the religious and the scientific domain have their own truth, their own authority that need to be integrated, but integrated by allowing them each their own turf. There's no conflict because they can't speak to the same kind of reality. And this was the answer for quite a while for Christians in the experimental sciences. What integrationists generally accept is that there's truth in both areas that have to be somehow jointly positioned or put together. Exactly how that occurs, of course, we haven't decided. You all agree on one approach here at Wheaton, I'm sure, among your faculty? So we don't at Regent either. So that it's intentional, that we believe there's truth in both domains, that's clear. Exactly how we do it, not so clear. We're still exploring that one. And that's been the preoccupation with us for the last 30 years in the integrationist movement. One of the major ways we did that in the 70s and 80s was by typing people in the way they approached it. Well, you're one of those, or you're one of those, you're one of those. It's like the integrationist version of a Myers-Briggs, right? So that's what we did. And this was largely influenced by a theological work by a neo-Orthodox scholar, Niebuhr. In his book, Christ and Culture, written in the mid-20th century, he looked at Christian history and said there's different ways that people have related to culture based on their faith. He came up with this category. So Bruce Nora told me those categories inspired the categories they used in their book on integration. That's where they got them. But independent of those typologies, we had people that argued for a levels of analysis view, which argued that we could do a complete account of the person, of the human person, at a biological mechanistic level or neuroscience level without making any reference to meanings, intentions, or sort of spiritual themes. But that would not exhaust the description. We would need a separate level of analysis at the level of meaning. Here's a great debate from the early 70s, 1971, between Skinner and Donald McKay. Skinner had just come out with his book, Beyond Freedom and Dignity. And Donald McKay was a physicist who applied some of what he was doing in systems physics to brain science. And he argued extensively, he was a respected British scientist, that a modern scientific understanding of the world is fully compatible with a Christian view of the world. And here they are talking about the Christian concept of hell and what to make of it. So this is Skinner on hell. We'll just play a few minutes of this, not the whole hour.
I think that the good, whether represented, personified in God, does represent those things which we find in the technical term reinforcing. They're the things which induce us to behave in certain ways, and evil is the ordinary Christian picture of hell is a collection of all the aversive stimuli available at the time. You did not have electric shock because it wasn't available. But these are the things. I should like to go back to your opening remark. When Milton Satan falls from heaven, he ends in hell. And what does he say to reassure himself? Here at least we shall be free. And that, I think, is the fate of the old-fashioned liberal. He's going to be free, but he's going to find himself in hell.
Well, I think that may be true of the old-fashioned liberal. I think indeed what Milton was on about there was the kind of freedom that wanted to be free from God. That was a theological point he was making. But a man who supposes that his real freedom is to be free of God is a man who is creating hell for himself. But it seems to me we've really got to try and get clear this, as I see it, logical fallacy underlying what Mr. Skinner said just now. I'd like to see if he would agree. Because he said he was doing translating when I was talking. And I think that this is a recurrent fallacy in a great deal of reductionist philosophizing based on psychology and physiology. And I think the best way to show it is in terms of an analogy. Suppose that an engineer came into an area where there were computers running and a lot of people standing around and anxiously worrying about whether their equations were well conditioned and as to how many roots the equations had and so on. This engineer might, if he knew enough electronics, develop a complete mechanical explanation of all that's going on in front of these people, purely in electronic terms. All right? In other words, you don't need anything but electronics in order to account, in a certain sense, for everything that's happening in the computer. On the other hand, when the mathematicians who are watching the computer say that they are watching the solution of Poisson's equation or something like that, they are not making a translation of what the engineer sees, nor is he making a translation of what they say. It's a logical mistake to regard the one as a translation of the other. They are correlates, but not translations. And if the engineer, Mr. Skinner won't mind a little tease, if the engineer were to pursue his fallacy and write a book called Beyond Mathematics on the ground that he had discovered how to make a translation of all the math quotes of all the mathematicians were saying without mentioning any mathematical concepts, he'd just be laughed at. They'd say, what can you do with such a man? He's making a fool of himself. Now, I do think it's most important to face this one, that as a matter of logical analysis, talking about reinforcements and so on at Professor Skinner's mechanistic level, or talking about nerve impulses and so on at the mountain, which I practice just as mechanistically as he does, these are not translations of what people say when they talk either about people or when they talk about God. We are talking about the significance of what's going on at the mechanical level in the kind of way that the mathematicians are talking about the mathematical significance of what's going on in the computer. And these are not translations, but correlates. So if I may come back to my point, I believe that God is to be reckoned with in something of the same sense that Mr. Skinner and yourself and all of us who are alive are to be reckoned with, i.e. not merely as objects, but as people who know that's at the human level, and God is at least to be reckoned with as one who knows us as we know one another. If that's true, I'm not saying that I'm proving it's true, but I'm saying if it's true, then it will not do logically to regard talk in these terms merely as a translation of talk at the other level.
Okay, we'll stop there. It's an interesting discussion. It certainly is important in the history of integration efforts. We understand what he's saying there. He's saying you can have a very traditional view of the person and of God and still have a completely naturalistic psychology. The two go together. Skinner saw no need for the folk psychology categories any longer, the talk about God or people or freedom. He just saw the mechanism. These are contemporary folks that would follow this approach. You might recognize the name David Myers, so he owns the textbook industry in psychology. Here's just a few of the typologies. I'm not going to go through all of these and explain them, but that emerged in that era. This was a book written by, I think it was a psychology major, or was he or not, but this was his undergrad project at Wheaton. It became an influential book. And then later on, Steve Evans came back and after his Yale degree, I think, right, and worked here. This is the Carter and Nairmore text that was sort of the integration Bible for a while at integration programs, based on the Reinhold Niebuhr text, Kirk Farnsworth's attempt. In the 1990s, Brian Eck looked at these decades of integration efforts and put together a meta-classification, and he came up with something that seems subtle and, by the way, in his article, but I think it was the major contribution. He described processes involved in each of these types. And I think the processes are actually more important because what we see some people doing is they try to find, well, that's what psychology teaches me and this is sort of what the Bible teaches about the person. Yeah, that fits together. They look for correlates of the two. So we certainly see a fair amount of that. There are people that try to slightly alter one concept in one discipline to make room for insights from the other. There are people that try to change the way you understand something to fit what the other discipline gives you, either Christianity towards psychology or vice versa. And then, of course, there are the anti-integrations, people that reject any attempt to influence one domain from the other. In the early 2000s, I argued based on hermeneutical theory for this kind of process model to be thought of as an interpretive process. And this takes us too far afield, but this is influenced by Gadamer, Ricoeur, other contemporary hermeneutics models. But this idea that to integrate is to take two domains of understanding and learn how to hear them both, being fully faithful to each domain. And that will require creative engagement of the two. That doesn't mean, by the way, that it's only rethinking or reinterpreting or translating, as McKay and Skinner talked about, at one domain. It may actually change your claims in one domain when you hear the other side correctly. So there can be factual claims about the brain or human nature that could come from the Bible. I'm not saying there are, I'm saying there could be. We won't know that till after we listen to Scripture fully. So I'm not making any a priori decisions about how one area can inform the other. Okay. More recently, what Mark Yarhouse and I are doing is thinking about integration, not so much as types or processes, but as areas where we engage integration, areas where we attempt to pull this off. So domains are autonomous spheres. They're areas of activity that can be separated from each other, at least by rough boundaries. So we certainly see in modern psychiatry and medicine this idea of life domains. Kuiper had this idea in social structures in society. Let's start with one called personal integration. So one of the ways we integrate is as people. We just integrate based on our life journeys, our personality, our temperament. I think this has been mentioned several times in our field, but I don't know that it's been adequately explored. Worldview integration, there was quite a bit of work done on this by Cosgrove and others 30 years ago. But you look at the assumptions underlying psychology, and you think about what it would be like to do that same work in social psychology, cognitive psychology, counseling, any other area, but from distinctively Christian beliefs. You reposition psychology on biblical worldviews. So the major worldviews that impact psychology, of course, are naturalism, pantheism, and postmodernism. These are the major features of naturalism, again, using broad family traits. Any particular naturalist may vary a bit on this. But these folks are materialistic. They believed in mechanistic uniformity. So if we can understand the mechanism that makes things work, we can expect that to be a reliable process that can be replicated. They believe that you can reduce the realm of folk psychology, the person, to the mechanistic realm. Death is the end of existence. It's the final exit, as the atheist existentialists have said. History is linear, typically, from this point of view, but without teleology, it's not heading anywhere on purpose. And ethics is simply human valuation, maybe the pursuit of pleasure and the avoidance of pain. Now, I'm not a naturalist, and the reason I'm not a naturalist throughout my career, these are the basic reasons. First of all, following arguments like those Plantinga has given, I don't see how naturalists can have any confidence that our knowing faculties produce truth. Following those kind of arguments for years, I still remain convinced that naturalistic categories give us no guarantee of truth or no confidence, even, that we have truth. One example I'll give. Marjorie Green, who was an early 20th century philosopher, studied with Heidegger, worked with Hempel at University of Chicago, a prominent philosopher of science in the 20th century, gave a talk at our graduate program on Descartes. She herself was not a Christian believer. She was an atheist. But she was always impressed by Descartes' reference to God as the source of confidence in our knowledge about the external world. And she said she often wondered when she left her lab with Hempel, where they were doing symbolic logic to describe how science could accurately tell us about the world, she'd drive across the bridges in Chicago, she said, and wonder why the bridges would obey the laws simply because they had developed this elaborate symbol system. So why did the world fit their pictures of the world? Why did it follow it? And for Descartes, it was God, that God isn't a deceptive God or capricious God. So if we're responsible knowers, he won't allow us to be capriciously deceived. That was Descartes' confidence. And she had nothing to give us. Some evolutionary epistemologists try to use evolution for that, but I still don't see any reason why evolution would give us anything more than useful ideas. And if we know from research by Marty Seligman and others, sometimes the most useful ideas for temporary adaptive reasons are not the most accurate. So optimists do better in life than pessimists, even though pessimists are more accurate in predicting how they will do, because the optimists persist longer, thinking they're going to do better. Also, I don't know how we really give a foundation to morals or to beauty or meaning from a naturalistic standpoint. I'm not saying naturalists don't have those things. Certainly many of them do. I'm just saying they don't have a good ideological basis for them. I think there are explanatory problems around the nature of consciousness. Even Thomas Nagel, prominent naturalist, most recently has written a very powerful critique of the naturalist explanation of consciousness called Mind and Cosmos. Now, to give you a sense of who Nagel is, he's famous for the quote, it's not just that he doesn't believe in God, he very much wants there not to be a God. Okay, so that's Nagel. And yet he thinks that Darwinian naturalism is incapable of explaining consciousness. That's the thesis of that book. I think he's right. I'm not anti-evolutionary. I'm just talking about the naturalistic version of this. Finally, I don't think the world really fits what naturalists think. So I was at a discussion group with some people from Colombia that are more New Age oriented or are transpersonalists. Two people from the Pear Labs at Princeton that are doing research on how the mind can manipulate reality, so ESP kinds of things. And two folks that run the Eastman Center at University of Virginia. This is the Kodak Eastman people funded this. It's a center that's very well funded, so it continues to operate, but UVA doesn't advertise it much. They're the ones where Raymond Moody was that did the research on near-death, life-after-life experiences. They collect all these reports. Gary Habermas at Liberty University, head of the doctor program in religion there, has been looking at these things from a Christian point of view, and he's not saying that we can take near-death experiences and develop a biblically trustworthy eschatology from them. But what he's saying is when you look at the details from the near-death experiences, they start to become very hard to explain from a purely naturalistic standpoint. If naturalism is right, something very strange is going on in the world. So the last point I'll say about that is, two points. This recent two-volume book by Craig Keener at Asbury on miracles has challenged in a very clever way a long tradition of contemporary New Testament scholarship. So since Hume, the basic assumption was we live in a world that's non-miraculous. So for a Christian to make a case that we should believe the miracle stories in the Bible, we have to say, we have to make special pleading. We have to say, we know that this is really a non-miraculous world. We really, really know it. But this is just such a unique case. Please believe it anyhow, or at least don't treat us as crazy for believing it. And that's like conservative responses to liberal views of the scripture for the last 200 years. What he's done now is spent an entire volume documenting from around the world how common miracle experiences are, reports of miracle experiences. And the clever thing about his book is that he's not saying any of them are true. He's just challenging Hume's claim that we live in a non-miraculous world. He's saying there is no reason to suppose a priori Hume's right about that. And if we might live in a world where the miraculous can occur, then what reason do we have to doubt the New Testament stories? It repositions all of New Testament scholarship. I think Christianity Today gave the book of the year to this two-volume set a couple years ago. It's a very clever approach. And then, of course, the resurrection, the Easter story. So I was studying with Anthony Flew, the British atheist, in the 80s, and he went to debate Gary Habermas on the resurrection. That later on became a book Harper and Row published called Did Jesus Rise from the Dead? And he came back from that, and he was looking a little dejected. I mean, this is a guy who gave a paper as an undergraduate at Oxford to C.S. Lewis and his club, and that paper became the most cited philosophy paper of the last half of the 20th century. So it set the stage for contemporary atheism. So he wasn't discouraged often in his atheist debates. But he couldn't come up with a good response to any of the evidences for the resurrection Gary had. They were friendly, but he couldn't. His basic position was, to put it in his terms, we live in a world where dead men don't get up and walk. So the possibility that there is an explanation other than that Jesus rose is more likely, even if I don't know what it is now, than that he actually rose. But there's a problem with that argument based on Hume. If Jesus was raised from the dead, he's wrong. We don't live in a world where dead men don't get up and walk. We may live in a world where none of us have seen a dead man get up and walk, or where it doesn't happen often, but if it only might happen sometimes, then you can't use that as evidence against the resurrection claims. So this kind of thing goes on, and then there are people out of Colombia, certainly the transpersonalists in psychology, that argue that we don't really live in a materialistic universe anyhow, but they want to approach it from a different perspective than Christians tend to view the world. But still, materialism is not necessarily on the comfortable footing it once was. And there's no reason for us to concede that it should be. Christian theism, I think, provides another foundation that makes more sense. It does a number of things for us. I think it gives us a foundation for why we should believe truth is possible. It doesn't mean every Christian has more knowledge than every non-Christian. I'm not saying anything like that. But why anyone that has knowledge can have knowledge because of God's providence in how we've been built and designed. It gives a basis to meaning, to morals. This is certainly Lewis's argument, so the foundation of morality. It makes sense when we look at the way the world is. It pulls things together in a way that describes all of reality. It makes more sense to me than the alternatives, at least that I've encountered in my life. Okay, theoretical integration. So we also try to build theories from an integrationist standpoint. I'm going to just quickly move through these, but if you look at the definitions of integration in a number of the articles in the 70s and 80s, many of them talk about cognitive stuff, faith and learning, integration. So putting together how we think as a Christian and how we think as a member of our discipline. Bob Emmons is someone who did some of this in secular psychology, became a Christian in his doctoral studies, Baptist background. He approached the person in light of taking spirituality seriously as a motivation in human life. He's got some interesting data. I've been arguing for something like this more recently. I've been arguing that religion plays a particularly unique role in motivation because it encompasses all of life and it's self-reinforcing. So it's not that there's necessarily any one distinct religious motive, but the religion is the master umbrella that covers all of life. So all things become linked, like the pillars under Venice. No one of those hold the city up, but all of them together. So someone may go to a youth group as a teenager because they want to date the cheerleader. Then they start going to the youth group and find out there's something interesting about being a Christian. They start having religious experiences. The cheerleader is no longer interesting to them or rejected them, but they stay for those other reasons. And then if you grow up in a church, there can be lots of reasons that keep us engaged, and that these foundations occur in a way that I don't think any other human institution comes close to. So in a traditional faith, it's so self-reinforcing and overlapping that it has a force that's additive and cumulative, even though every single path could be described in completely secular terms of the unique influences. So religion is the multi-final outcome of what drives a person of faith, even though the individual routes to getting there could be described in secular reductionistic terms, perhaps. But what isn't explainable in a secular term is the robustness and perseverance of religion, the way it can so adequately unite all the things in life that humans are influenced by. Now, that could be just a very strange coincidence that's going to make religion a very hard thing to stamp out if it's false, or it could be because God designed it that way. It's providence. Of course, I think it's the latter. I'm going to move through this in the interest of time here. That clock is right, correct? Okay. So there was a theme at the Vision 36 mid-year meeting a couple months ago in New York. So a psychologist, developmental social psychologist from Yale, was arguing that religion simply is a way of doing things with a religious label that is at their core non-religious. So he didn't see any particular value in religion and that we could do all the things religion does, the completely secular methods. His title of his talk was, "What's So Special About Religion?" What I want to suggest is that everything becomes special because of religion. It imbues this scaffolding or reinforcing of linking all the things in our life. And certainly that's what Emmons has found in his research. He found that there are spiritual goals that can be specifically identified. These goals are more superordinate. They tie together things from lots of other areas. People that have spiritual goals tend to have better goal accomplishment. They have less goal conflict in their life. That may explain some of the other things people have found about religion. Okay, clinical integration. So how do we actually engage faith in clinical practice? So Tan has talked about explicit and implicit integration. Here's just some of the approaches that are most well known, I think. Religiously accommodative CBT has the most research behind it, the early studies by Prost and the number of studies since. Forgiveness protocols, God image therapies, hope-focused marriage counseling by Bob Worthington. David Rosemarin at Harvard, I mentioned this to some of you earlier, has just done a study where they've looked at this typical probe question people are taught to ask. So are you religious or spiritual? If someone says no, then to be sensitive ethically, you're supposed to move on, right? So what he's found is that if you ask people, would you like religious or spiritual themes to be addressed in your treatment, even among those people who say, I'm not religious or spiritual at all, nearly over a third, actually, say yes, they want it to be part of treatment at Harvard. or you have to like have your secular card to walk in the door, right? So it's like it's a powerful thing that we've neglected. And then role integration. This is really the themes I want to end on today. I think this is an ancient issue that Christians struggled with. We see writings in the church and fathers and the patristics about Roman soldiers who become Christians. And some Christians argue, well, they have to quit. Doesn't matter if they become deserters. You can't be a Christian, be a Roman soldier. To not put it too delicately, one of the quotes was, it's like a dog returning to its vomit. So if they go back to being a Roman soldier. And others said, no, we can, and that's how we be a witness for Christ. We just have to behave in some kind of Christian way, whatever that means as a Roman soldier. And the debate went back and forth. What is that but a discussion about role integration? We have those discussions now. It might be easy to figure out how to be a Christian plumber, right? You need the fish on your card and things like that. But maybe have ethical business practices. What does it mean to be a Christian counselor, psychologist, social worker? Well, when you enter this field, if you become licensed, you're accepting a public trust. It means you're operating in a fiduciary space. I've heard Christians say this. I'm going to get my license. I'm going to go do what I want to do. I'm going to still pray with clients. I'm not going to work. See, the thing is, though, when you're licensed, you're saying to the entire jurisdiction that licensed you, I'll abide by your oversight. I'll practice in a way that I could defend to you. If you're not going to do that, it just seems to me an issue of integrity for a Christian to accept a license. Like, become a pastoral counselor, be a coach, do something else. But when you say, I'm going to do this and not do it with sincerity, it seems like a pretty easy ethical call for a Christian to make. There's something improper in that. Well, what if they ask us to do things we really can't do as a Christian? Well, this is a Daniel moment, right? So then we're going to have to figure out what to do about that. But certainly entering the profession with an intention to evade seems to me a problem. So what would or should a behavioral science or profession fully or adequately integrated with Christianity look like? So I don't know exactly, but I suspect it's going to have a greater premium on human meaning. So Jamie, Dr. Ayton and I were talking yesterday about dealing with end-of-life issues or life crises with meaning issues. Excuse me. And I suspect we'd be much better at that if we had a more thoroughly Christian psychology. There is some evidence that there might be room for some of this lately. There's more Christian engagement in the profession. There's groups like Acervic, which aren't fully Christian, but it's at least giving us a forum. Economics is helping APA consider these things more. Christian continuing ed seminars that focus on spiritual themes always sell out. The Christian books are selling well, etc. Research on religion and health outcomes has been helpful. As Dan Robinson said after Carl Thorson presented on this, a Stanford researcher at a meeting at APA, Dan Robinson, who's a psychologist, Christian, he argued that, or he said, so what the Surgeon General should say is warning, atheism could be dangerous to your health. Maybe that's a bit of an exaggeration, but the reality is that we do see benefits involved with traditional religious affiliation, not specifically Christian, but religious in general. So proactive integration. I think if we were to not wait for the field to define psychology in its research methods or counseling or psychology in its professional context, but instead see ourselves when we enter the field as full members of the profession and not just wait for the rules to be defined that we have to then figure out how to be Christians within, but instead go out and help shape those. Get on committees, have our voices be heard, do the same kind of advocacy other groups that feel that they've been left out or marginalized within the professions have done. I think we might be able to have some impact here that would make it easier for the integration project to move forward, still being responsive to the broader society and to regulators. But I'm not arguing for triumphalism here. I'm not arguing that we Christianize the whole world, take back the academy, make it all, you know, church school. That's not what I'm arguing for. I don't think that's realistic. Of course, in the end, the return of Christ, fine. But we'll let him win that battle. Right now, we want to be faithful Christians in our disciplines. That's the space we need to argue for. Now, it may turn out that we would accumulate enough evidence over time to show the clear, to use the triumphalist phrase, the superiority of the Christian view of the world. And if that happens, it should speak for itself. But if it happens by us using political methods or oppression or marginalizing dissenting voices, I don't know that that's a Christian answer. I think that's maybe more where we were in the Middle Ages, right? So Rodney Stark has found some interesting data that suggests church engagement is actually higher now than it was in the Middle Ages, even though the power structures in society were more explicitly Christian, at least in a nominal sense then, in Europe. So let's look at the most recent battle that I'll end with, and that's over conscience clauses. And you know where this comes from, right? The Julia Ward case, the Jennifer Keaton case, largely out of counseling, sorry, counselors. So your niche. So we have those same battles in psychology, but we so intimidate our students that they don't bring lawsuits against us. So not being serious, I don't think, but maybe I am. So at any rate, Julia Ward, you know the story, right? You can follow this video link. We don't have time now, so I won't play it. So she was a student at Eastern Michigan University. In the latter stage of her program, she had been nearly a straight-A student or a straight-A student. She had made her conservative Christian beliefs known. She had a couple being referred to her for treatment that were gay, and she said to her supervisor, I can see this couple, but if they want me to affirm their relationship, I can't do that because of my beliefs. So what should I do? Should I refer them? Supervisor said, refer them. Then they said, come back tomorrow. She came back to see the supervisor tomorrow and said, you have three choices. Change what you think, voluntarily withdraw from the program after you have all this investment in, right? Or you can go through a formal disciplinary review. And what did she do wrong? She expressed this attitude, which let's grant the typical view of this in our profession. Even if it was an inappropriate and prejudiced attitude, she was doing anything. She was seeking advice about an issue that was difficult for her from her supervisor. She did what her supervisor asked. And it jumped right to this approach. So she wouldn't withdraw. She wasn't going to change her beliefs. So then she went to the formal review, where they engaged in what the district court judge called a theological bout with her at a state school, questioning whether or not her understanding of scripture was better than theirs, et cetera. So at a state school. So you can imagine how this played out, but not well. In the meantime, a bill was proposed in Michigan called the Julia Ward Act, which said no program in psychology, counseling, or social work will discipline or otherwise take negative action to a student who refers because of a religious conflict in training. Now that was stopped in committee. It didn't go through, but it scared a lot of people in our professions because they saw this as being a problem. Similarly, about a year later in Georgia, Jennifer Keaton had this kind of case, except Jennifer Keaton said she wouldn't treat sexual minorities in these cases, and the court did not find in her favor. So those are two different kinds of cases. Now, what ACA did, the American Counseling Association, after that, is change its ethic codes to say there's no values-based referral allowed or only value-based referral allowed within counseling. So that's the ethics code of counseling. Tennessee's Board of Counseling said that all counselors have to obey the ACA code. Tennessee has been voted the most conservative legislature of any state in the country right now. And so they decided to propose this. They're saying, guess what? The ACA code does not apply on this point to counselors, and it will not be used to judge counselors in Tennessee. And the law says that the state law trumps the ethics codes of the professional societies. So here's two video clips you can see, one from the people representing that motion, one from a GLBT advocacy group that's responding to it, and I think these are blunt instruments that set things up for polarized response. Now, to cut a long story short, in psychology for about 4 years, we've been working on an alternative path since the Julia Ward case to these kinds of options through a discussion group. And it's taken a long journey. I've been rather explicit with my Christian points of view here, with what I think the concerns are of Christians in these secular training programs. But the other folks on the working group are also equally concerned about the other areas. We've learned to try to find ways to meet each other's needs in this process. And I think the path that they've settled on is a competency framework. So rather than say that you have to, for instance, in a faith-based program, ignore any kind of sexual ethics standard in who stays in the program, or that you have to teach a certain point of view that may not be consistent with a biblical Christianity, the idea is that what is the interest of the professions to regulate? It's that you can competently see clients when you have them without doing injury to them, without doing harm. And competence is the key issue here. And I can tell you from looking at programs being reviewed for years, I don't know of a single Christian program that has any evidence in any of its accreditation reviews that its graduates have any systematic problem with dealing with sexual minority clients or any other flashpoint in the culture war area. And so there's no evidence empirically that we have a greater problem with this. In fact, what I often hear is what I'm told you heard from one of your practica supervisors, people like Kathy Bischke, who's a prominent advocate for GLBT concerns at APA, current chair of the Commission on Accreditation. Her students have done research and found that people from faith-based settings often have more competence because they've actually spent more time thinking about these issues than many people in secular settings, unless they're in one of those niche programs where it's a major focus. So, this path was of competency-based approaches means that the profession does have a right to come to Wheaton, to Regent, and say, whether it's counseling, marriage and family, or psychology, if you are out of this training context and a gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender client comes in your office, how can you engage that clinical activity in a competent way that doesn't do harm? So how can you do it? Now, that's not the same thing as saying that you have to do gay affirmative therapy, but nor do the APA guidelines require that, nor do any guidelines in any of the other professions I'm aware of. What they require is affirmative therapy in APA. So the 2009 Appropriate Therapeutic Responses to Sexual Orientation Policy of APA argues that you need to be able to affirm an individual's worth and dignity. It does caution against, come very close to banning, but not quite, anything like conversion therapy. But there's a big difference between that and requiring all people to do gay affirmative therapy. And so it does give Christians options. And from clinical practice, my own experience is you co-create your goals with clients. The kind of point of treatment is something you negotiate with them. And if you're an effective clinician, there should be an authentic space that you can create where you can, with integrity, help an individual. I've never had a client come to me and say, I need you to tell me it's okay that I believe X, Y, or Z. I need you to tell me it's okay that I've made this choice. I've never had a client exactly say that. What it is depression or anxiety or some internal conflict they're trying to deal with. I know Ken Pargament had one case closely like that, but it was from an evangelical minister in Midwest that didn't want to be confronted about an affair that he had made peace with having. And Ken didn't want to help him with that goal. He wanted to find out how to have his affair and still be a minister at the church. And Ken decided he wouldn't accept him for that therapy goal and passed him on to someone else. At any rate, I don't know that I've really heard of conflicts being set up this blatantly. And I think if it is, it's probably being done for non-clinical reasons. So this is just the statement we came up with. But what I wanted to point out here is that we had this working group that came in being concerned about making sure conscious clauses don't get enacted, that the mental health fields unite against them, so that sexual minorities are not marginalized and put in at-risk situations and getting help. We went from just that focus to an equal focus on taking a developmentally appropriate approach to people of faith, studying in secular programs, understanding that you have an obligation to model for them respect for diversity, including religious diversity, and how you supervise these students, that you shouldn't take a disciplinary approach as your first approach to dealing with these issues. For instance, in Julia Ward's case, if her supervisor would have called her in and said, okay, so you're in a small community somewhere, you're the only provider, these clients show up, how do you respond in a way that, tell me, let's role play it, how would you respond in a way that you could live with integrity, that would meet their needs, that would be helpful to them? Start helping her to think flexibly rather than forcing into a rigid reactance, which is where they took it. The field ended up there, at least in this working group, which has had some impact. It's been presented to the licensing boards, to the Education Bureau at APA, we've presented it to the leadership of APA, the Ethics Committee. The new standards on accreditation took this model and built it into their standards. So it's right at the bottom there. And some people, when that was being revised, I can tell you, wanted to remove footnote 4, the protection and rights of programs to admit and hire based on Christian faith considerations. We were able to argue that it's not about us being Christians, it's about whether or not we're training competent psychologists. We've presented that argument to ACA. The leadership at KCREP seemed open to it. There are some forces, though, that are bent on this culture war. They have their ire up. It's Hatfield versus the McCoys over the Julia Ward case. And I think you all have some work and counseling to do to redirect it. Now, we're trying to do that. I'm working with your team. We're going to try to help steer counseling away from the fight it's going down, which it doesn't need to do for its professional interest or the public's good. All right. I've taken up all my time with virtually very little time for questions, I think. So what does it mean to be an integrationist in psychology? It should be really clear after that meandering journey that I don't know. I really like being a Christian. I like being on most days in most moods. Some of the sermons are boring sometimes, but I really like it. I like being a psychologist. I like the mental health field, and I want to do both. And so that's what led me down this journey. Those are some of the things I've thought about as I've tried to get to where I am now, the way the field is there. My students have to hear this stuff, so you had to today as well. You can blame your folks that invited me here for that. So thank you. Three minutes. I don't know if you want to take a couple of questions.
Can you take a couple of questions?
Okay. Any questions, comments?
Yes. I was thinking about this in your guest lecture class, but what are some specific things that you view the Christian faith as being able to contribute to the field of psychology?
Well, I think we've already done a lot of it, and I think we've underappreciated that. I think psychology operates in a worldview from the common sense realist tradition, from a broader Augustinian tradition, that makes possible the kind of investigations we engage in. So you believe in a rational order that can be discerned through rational investigation, the idea that lawful patterns can be detected in nature, the idea when you look at our value system that humans have dignity and worth that should be respected. That didn't just come from anywhere. It's not that other traditions can't have those beliefs, but clearly the historical source of Western social science and psychology's major approaches to these things come from specifically Christian ideas in the academy. And I don't know that they really thought through what the alternative would be. So some people are. There's some folks out there thinking through what it would be like to be in a post Foucault world or something, but it's for the most part, I think that we've already done quite a bit. So I also think that even the multicultural movement is, its best elements come from things like the Roger Williams religious liberty tradition, and that's what gives it its space. And where it goes wrong is when it deviates from that into something else, into a kind of Roman Empire idea of pluralism that doesn't any longer make judgments except for those who don't play by the popular pluralism's rules. So Jonathan Haidt has talked a lot about that. So it's hard for us to step back and look at the water when we're fishing in an aquarium. But I think maybe part of the reason why we don't see us producing psychologists that are radically different than the psychologists that come from the state schools nearby is because it's the same world we're preparing people to work with, and much of the assumptions that have guided that have been broadly constituted by a Christian view of the world, even though we no longer remember that. It's like baggage we bring to the world, to the approach to psychology. And where we've gone wrong, we've often questioned those assumptions or deviated from them and come back to them. So that's not a scholarly treatise. Haight has really done this kind of thing in others on a scholarly level, but that's what I suspect. Now, are there things we can contribute, though, beyond just the context? I think there are. I think there are resources like we're starting to see happening in positive psychology with gratitude, the forgiveness intervention stuff. Jim Sells is doing some work now on the power of grace in relational work, trying to bring that idea forward. And it does create an interesting challenge to contract views of relationships, right? So in an exchange theory, you look for an even balance of give and take in a relationship. But how many of us can maintain that over life? Those of you in long-term relationships, are you always equally proportioned in your give and take? And if we'd kept a checklist, would that really set us up to succeed or to have constant squabbles? And so the grace approach gives not to get back, but out of gifts, out of a sense of grace. And I think it's an alternative framework that actually some secular folks have taken up his model and are doing some research around it. So just these low-level concepts we take for granted every Sunday can actually have clinical operationalizations. We probably have more that we don't even realize. So that's where I would recommend the field go. But what I would love to see your generation do is, as I mentioned in class, bring the gospel to our profession. That is, not be proselytizing and bringing the four spiritual laws to every convention and offer, you know, making an altar call at the end of your professional presentations, but instead talking about the Christian view of the world in a way where people see why it's good news for our profession. I don't think that's the standard reaction we're getting. We really should make it that, because it really should be. When you look at an accurate historical assessment of Christianity, it's a human endeavor. Christ is not human, but Christianity is a human endeavor. And we've got lots of errors and flaws, but I would put this against any other human movement, and it's because I don't think it's just a human movement. But I think we've had providential influence on the world that a number of people have written about. This is sometimes called the field of cultural apologetics. And I think there's value in us thinking through some of that. Okay.